My name is Alexey Buzdin. I hail from Latvia, Riga. I'm an organizer at Google Development Group in Riga, and also organizer at the biggest IT conference, Riga DevDay. Okay, so let's start. And to start, I have a quote, since it's a Game of Thrones evening today. We came here to kick ass and test your services, and you're all out of services. Let's start testing RESTful services. So, first, let's have a tale. So, a long time ago, in a long galaxy, a long time ago, we had spaghetti architecture, right? 10 years ago, 15 years ago. And how did we test it, actually? Monkey style, like, we had quality engineers who were doing some monkey testing. But years came, things evolved, and we got a new style of architecture. Lasagna, hey! And with this new approach, new possibilities for automation testing has appeared. And now we have lots of layers, like presentation layer, business layer, data access layer. And the idea was that you can like take this, push it away, and put another database here without breaking the presentation, the business layer. Sounds cool, interesting. And this setup also provided us with a new style of testing. Testing integrations, when you can put two groups and see if they connect, right? Then things got evolved, and you would say that we have a pyramid, Maslow's pyramid of testing, where we have unit testing, integration or service testing, and UI automation. Then we thought about it, decided that the effort of UI automation is more than writing pure unit tests. The cost is also higher. So what are we going to do? So right now, we have yet another architecture style. By the way, what is it? Ravioli, yes, from the first try. So some say that it's pelmeni, but it's ravioli because it's like not the same dough type. So with ravioli, with microservices, we have another complication. How we can test those? Because the idea of microservices is like huge. You have all those small nodes. You have different client sites, you have different databases, you have different message brokers, nodes, etc., etc. And now try to write a Selenium test upon it. Yeah? And it's like will trigger a blast completely. So UI automation doesn't work here in this field with all the integrations. So API became the new UI. And now we could actually test API for a microservice to assure that it's working, and you can plug it and use it. So why API tests? First, you should test routing. What do I mean by that? Let's, again, deep dive into long ages past when we had servlets. So this is servlet 2.0, and it was really simple. Yeah? You have request, you have response, you can do what the heck you want here. And it can easily be testable. You just write a JUnit test and say, OK, I should get a not found status code, or I should get an OK status code. Really easy. Now try to write JUnit test for this. And it gets complicated. OK, we can say, I can write a JUnit test for getNet, but you won't test routing. Does anyone know how to test this, to test if actually Spring will invoke get if the URL is slash. This is HTTP testing, right? So it's complicated if we compare to this one. So next thing, serialization, deserialization. Again, in servlets, it's transparent. We see that we either use a mapper or we use it by hand by set. Here, some magic is happening, because we see my bin, it somehow serializes by Spring internals, by Spring rules, and we don't know how it does it. If there is some JAX bin validations, it should also trigger bin validation and throw some errors. If there are some custom rules, you should also check that. If you do not check it, something can get wrong. So test server responses. Also, you could have a gazillion different status codes, headers, etc., etc. With plain JUnit, it's hard to test it. You cannot be assured that if a client doesn't provide a cookie header, a bad request will be returned, right? And also, if we test API, QAs can do it. They don't need to know, actually, how the application works. They just need to have a spec and say that if I put a header here, I should get a header there. That's it. Okay, so first, we have this huge landscape of microservices, and to test this one, we need to somehow isolate it. And it could be quite hard. If you have already a landscape of 10, 20 microservices, not that easy to pick one aside and test it, test its API. So first, if you think about doing microservices, you should also think about designing your integration to be easily pluggable and mockable. For example, you could use Spring integration. So Spring integration is a great tool, which Jürgen mentioned during his talk today, which allows you to do an interface over either HTTP connection or MQ connection or some other connection, right? So here, what do? We say that we have an interface called com my request gateway. And it is somehow connected to this HTTP call to this URL. And in Java code, it would be just out of wire of request gateway. How we can test it? Provide different configuration. We could do a mock implementation and use it, right? So we abstracted and like removed the obstacle of external system with integrations. If you don't have that option, if there is already a legacy code, you cannot alter it, you could mock some web services and repoint the location. There are a couple of tools, great ones, like Mocko, which allow you to create a JSON specification and say which kind of requests are bound to which kind of responses. So this, you could just run with a common jar file or as a Java code and actually get a mock replica of some web service, which you can then repoint to. Another alternative is WireMock. Yeah? So this is also a great tool, has a very flexible API, Java one, and also JUnit support. So this will actually start up a server in your JUnit tests, which you can repoint. So next problem, we've dealt with all integrations, HTTP ones, and now we need to deal somehow with database. With database, it's a bit harder because there's no like good way how to mock a database. You can either create an in-memory one if you have ORM, yeah, because you just need to like take H2 or Derby or HSQL or any other. You could create a clean instance of database, you could reuse one, or you could mock data from the file system. But nothing is good here. Yeah, with database, it's a bit complicated. So now you have like put aside a small unit of microservices which you can test. And the next question is, do you use an application server? So who of you is using an application server as a, yep, okay, good. So with this, you have small problems because you don't have a main method, right? You cannot just start it out. So for Spring, it's easier. They have a bundled in class runners, which starts up the Spring context. So here, you'll have your application ready on this port. With Java EE, or some other frameworks that are using application container and don't have a main method, you could use Arquillion. Great tool that allows you to create a WAR file. And then you can deploy this WAR file to any application service or web service available. For example, Arquillion supports Tomcat, Wildfly, Glassfish, and Jetty, I think. Yep. Basically, all the major ones. So this is, could be a handy tool for you to start up a service in test. So now we've started up an environment. We isolated it from other HTTP and database thingies. And now let's test. So, who has used Rest Assured? Please raise your hand. Great, then you'll know a lot of more interesting things from this presentation. So basically what Rest Assured is a very powerful library that allows you to do smart curls, basically HTTP requests, in BDD fashion. So here we say, given this port, and this URL, do a GET request. And then be assured that the response has a status code 200. OK. And this will actually run. Yeah. And you can build upon it more complex thingies. Like here, you can send parameters, query parameters, or pass parameters. You could put cookies, different body, headers. And in the then, in the assertion step, you can assert also the headers, cookies, parameters, etc. Yeah. So if you want to test an actual HTTP server, rest assured is the best tool in Java right now for that. And the presentation will contain some hints. So first hint, if you want to write HTTP tests, don't hard code the port like here and the URL. Try to make it extendable, because at any time you would like to test different environment. Yeah? So make your URL port configurable in some property files. OK, so now let's try to do some sample server and try to test it and see how many tests we need to write to be assured that it is working correctly. And since we have, again, so the Game of Thrones team, we'll use something connected to Game of Thrones. So we have a resource called houses, as Sebastian mentioned. And we have all the CRUD operations. Let's start with GET. So here is a sample rest assured test. Here, for simplicity, I'm using human JSON. So human JSON is a cool library that allows you to skip writing all the double quotes, all the semicolons, etc. So you can just use it as a config file. So rest assures allow you to pass objects here instead of JSON, but it wouldn't suit our presentation well because it's two files. So here, what do? We send this body as a post to houses, and we are waiting for 201. Question to you, are we assured that everything works fine on the server with this request? What are we missing? OK, yeah. How we can test it, for example, our server could pass location that Lannisters contain, have the Iron Throne right now. And OK, so we can test the header. What we actually tested? We tested that application started, the resource collection exists. It doesn't give us 404. That provided JSON is parsed successfully, because all this magic that happens in Spring or Java EE about serialization, deserialization will fail if some bin validation will not work. And there are no validation errors. But we haven't tested if the item was created on a server. We don't know. We just see that there is a URL, there is a header, there is a status code. And actually, we should, theoretically, first assert the header, and then do a GET request on location, and see if it's 200 there. Because our code providing status codes could be wrong, theoretically. And it's been so in my experience, that someone just like caught exception and sent OK. And without this kind of test, dumb tests, you couldn't test it. So maybe you can have a couple of those smoke tests in your application. Yeah. So now we at least know that resources are somehow stored on the server. Or the server is completely broken and giving out OK status codes for every request. And again, what did we miss? So here, theoretically, we have the JSON body that we're sending, and we haven't tested the actual data. So we don't know if this exact data was saved into a database. Maybe we missed something. Maybe there is there isn't a binding for sigil or for words on our ORM model. So theoretically, we could also do assertion and take this JSON and try to verify that all properties are there. And again, in some cases, you can get errors. One of the errors we get with this kind of testing is that we had problems on Oracle. We didn't set Unicode. and all the Unicode symbols were like completely gone. Yeah? And again, if we haven't did this kind of tests, we wouldn't know that there is an issue with Unicode symbols because we don't check it. Okay, so what else? Again, if here we're trying to do equals, we say that the response should be exactly like this, like we send it. The approach is also a bit wrong. Why? Because server could generate a lot of different stuff for us, created on, updated on, generated IDs, etc. So if you want to test an HTTP server, you should like test the contains. That the response contains name equals to Lannister, that it contains lore dot sigil equals to something else, etc. Because if the ID will be here, your test of equality will break. And for that, we have the JSON pass. So JSON pass is really powerful, and it is supported by Rest Assured very well. And you can assert, for example, only one property, lore.words. Also, when you start testing RESTful services like in this way, you will get in trouble when you want to test arrays. Because you don't think about ordering those arrays when you just read them from the database. And possibly, if you give it to the testers, they'll write something like this. Members 0 should be equal source A. But it won't in some cases. In some cases, your build will fail, and you won't understand why. Yeah. So again, either implement an order in advance or teach testers to use contain matchers that test contains over the array. And OK, so to sum up, we're using the black box approach here. We don't know what was created on a data on a server, and we need to verify each step if we want to be completely sure that something is working there. And again, don't try to use the same data over all the tests, because when you'll try to run it parallel, you'll get some issues. You'll try to create an item that was already deleted, but something is updating it, and you'll have problems. So theoretically, each test cases, HTTP test case, should be isolated like this. And then you can run them parallel, which will be a smaller improvement in speed. So if you use Maven, you could use max parallel forks. If you use Gradle, you can also set up the parallel forks count. OK, so what actually we can test with POST? We can test, we already tested created. We can theoretically miss a mandatory property. We should get bad request. We can test that validation fails. It should get us back a bad request. We could theoretically, if we have a locking mechanism on our server, we should get a conflict if someone is using this resource already. And unsupported media types. If you're trying to pass an XML that's not supported, or CSV it's not supported, it should give you back 450. Why is it so? Because if a person will work with your server, it doesn't know the internals, he will not understand how to deal with the issue he's having. So try to expose as much sensible information to the client, not Java exception stack traces, but like sensible errors that the client can understand. Maybe a UI team will work apart from you. Okay, we covered POST. What else in GET we can do? So we've tested OK status code. We could test not found, because in some cases, in some wrong configurations, for not found it could throw 500 internal error, which is bad for us. Again, unsupported media types. What could we do with a delete? Again, not found, OK, forbidden. Yep. With put, not found, OK, bad request, validation failed, bad request, forbidden. So as you can see, there's a lot of stuff could happen on a simple CRUD server to do it correctly. And to my knowledge, right now, there is no like automatical way to put all those status codes in place, sadly. So you need to theoretically do it somehow manually. again, if we know that there's a lot of status codes, there's a lot of different headers we're using, we need to invest our time in describing our API. So one of the alternatives, a good one, is Swagger, open API. And for that, how Swagger deals with it, why it is unique? Because it produces the JSON file describing all your HTTP server or your RESTful server. And by going to the JSON file, you can check what kind of HTTP methods are available there, what kind of responses could happen there. So any client could read this information and based on it, do some decisions. You could also put a Swagger UI on top of it, and then you can hand to your design, to your UI team or to an integration team this pretty looking specification that they actually can use to understand what's happening on the server. There are a couple of technologies that you could use to generate this Swagger spec. So if you're using Spring, there is a cool technology called SpringFox, which automatically, with this small configuration, will construct a Swagger documentation for your Spring MVC services, which is really cool. So you just need to write like, what, 7 lines, and you have a running documentation. It will have some issues. It won't have all the status codes in place, but at least it will have all the resources, all the controllers. If you're using DragSRF, yeah, there's another great tool that Sebastian created. Yeah, it's a DragSRF analyzer, which does exactly the same as SpringFox, apart from that it doesn't have a built-in Swagger UI. So this will create a Swagger JSON and expose it on a server for DragSRF bindings. So using these two tools, you can already create a documentation that will help teams running tests, creating tests, and integrating with the services. There are a couple of alternatives to Swagger, but they are not like ideally suitable for my taste. So one is RAML, second one is API Blueprint. So I won't mention them in more details, but there is a great topic explaining what API documentation tool you should use in your use case. Yep. Okay. One issue, big issue when you stumble upon doing HTTP tests is when you have an asynchronous API. Because here, things are getting a bit complicated. So with sent a house, we got 202, and then we get a location. But it wasn't created at that point of time. We cannot just do a GET request. We need to wait. There's a cool library from the same guys who did a REST assured called Availability, which allows you to do simple blocking waits. Waits are bad, but at least you can work with asynchronous APIs this way. So what does it do? You say, I need to wait until something, and then tell what kind of poll interval and delay interval you're using. And here, you're using JUnit hump crest matchers. So you can do them as flexible as you want. And if you have HateOS plus asynchronous API, then you get even more problems. You should somehow balance both the links and both the asynchronous nature of the API. Okay, so what else REST Assured has inside? So it has a lot of built-in authentication mechanisms, like form authentication, basic authentication, certificates, OAuth2. And they're all one-liners. You just need to provide the credentials and you're set, you're in. Also, if you're sitting behind a corporate proxy, you have a solution. There's a one-liner support for proxy, which is really great. If you don't want to test the data, you can use JSON schema validation. So you can just be assured that the data is at least approximately correct, like in their nature. So multi-value headers and cookies, multi-part form data. So you could send files with that. Filters. So filters are a cool thing that you can set between your HTTP requests and then do some magic based on the data sent on request. So you can say, if something went bad, I want to like do a logging or something. What were the main points of this presentation? So first, in addition to unit integration UI testing, at least cover your main functionality with API tests. It will help you a lot to debug. So try to design your integration to be easily pluggable and mockable. So you will save some time when you try to test them. The couple connection settings from the source code. So you don't want to have hard-coded URLs, ports, etc., etc. And never use equals to compare objects when you compare the results server responses, because there could be some generated stuff that you don't know in advance. Don't rely on existing data. So all the tests should be atomic and isolated. Design your tests to be easily parallel, because you want to have them efficient and performance-wise. And also, invest having a descriptive API. It will help both the development team and the testers. And if you want to assert the results, you could use JSON pass and XPath. And the last, one of the last slides is tools to look at. So it would be really great if you could take a look at Rest Assured, if you haven't done so. Have a utility, Swagger, RAML, API Blueprint, Aquilion, those Wiresharks and Mocko, and HJSON. They would be really helpful for some cases for you. And the last but not the least, tests are made to make you feel secure, like a lovely hug. So thank you. If you have any questions, I have time now. And if you liked my talk, there are a couple of more talks at my Twitter, and I'm posting regular information and Java news and Android news. OK, so any questions? Yeah, sure. Yep. So in real life, you would use an object. Here, why did I use JSON? First, it was easier to paste on a slide. Second, I wanted to show you a cool human JSON library. Two use cases.
Okay, that's all, thanks.
Okay, any other questions?